We can start, yeah. Hello, everybody. Today I'm going to talk about our mobile applications in Ryanair. First, let me introduce myself. My name is Vladimir Atanasov. I'm the lead Android developer in Ryanair. So first, how many of you are actually familiar with this airliner, Ryanair? How many of you know about it? Cool, that's a lot. And how many of you have actually flown with it? Okay. And how many of you like flying with Ryanair? Nobody. Okay, yeah. That was expected. So a little bit of history. We just turned 30. The airliner is exactly my age. We are number one in traffic in Europe. We have over 100 million customers yearly. We have 73 bases all over Europe. You can see the European map is quite dense. We have several airports in North Africa. We have 1,600 daily flights, and we cover 190 destinations in more than 30 countries. Our fleet consists of 330 Boeing 737-800s with 380 Boeings on order. Now, this is very important. We have only one type of aircraft, which makes running costs, it decreases running costs. And so the average age of our airplanes is actually 1 year, which is pretty cool. Now, this is our market share. So we are the biggest, we have the biggest market share in Europe, as you can see. And the other thing to notice is we actually have a pretty serious competition. So it's not easy being Ryanair. In terms of savings, you can see the prices. So we are the only ultra low cost airline in Europe. Our average fare is around 46 euro. Our competitor average fare is around 163 euro. How we accomplish these things is with a lot of brains. So we try to reduce operational costs in any way possible. Like, for example, the what I mentioned before is we have only one type of aircraft which significantly reduces the costs and makes things very easy to maintain. We are trying to we are investing a lot in technology. For example, until 5 years ago, 90% of the bookings happened over the phone. Today, we have 100% bookings happening online in one form or another, through our website, through our mobile applications, which also reduces the cost. And this actually, all of these things, they affect the ticket price, which is very good for our customers. Now, that said, Ryanair has a very, doesn't have a very good image with the customers, but now we started following a new, always getting better program, which, so we basically try to create a more family-friendly environment and increase the trust of the customers in us. And we've been following this for, I think, 2 years now, and it's been great success. So for the last year, Ryanair increased their full-year profit with 66%. And the most significant change that we made was actually introducing this new program, the Always Getting Better program, which, as you can see from this quote, this had a bigger impact on our business than actually the drop of the oil prices. Now, it's very challenging to work in the company because people love to hate us. I mean, this is the company that we are. And things are improving, but they're not improving with the speed that we want. So now I'm going to start talking about our application. This is the focus of the talk. I want to show you our old application, so you can see it on the left. Our old application compared to the new application, which is using Couchbase. So what we did was, in the old application, we had, Wayne mentioned that, we had a client-server architecture. So we were basically loading all the resources. So this is stations, this is seat maps, countries, and other resources. We were loading them every time the user starts a journey. And you can see from here, it's not a very good experience. So the application is running exactly the same environment, so on the same device with the same network conditions, and you can see the difference is big. And in the new application, we are already we're already purchasing services, and in the old application, we still try to make a search. Now, so one reason was we switched from hybrid to native. This obviously improved things a lot, but the biggest improvement came from actually storing all this semi-static data on the device itself. So we eliminated all these loading times that you see there. And as you can see from the video, I'm already on the payment screen. And with the old application, I'm still struggling with my passenger details. So what we store in the documents, they're quite big. So we store the all the stations, including the markets. So the markets means we have a relation between the station of origin to where it can fly to. For example, Dublin can fly to 30 other stations, and we need to store this relation somewhere. So today we have it in the database, in the local database, in the local bucket. And this improves performance of the application a lot. You can see the how both applications perform. Now, these are the ratings of the road application. It was, as you can see, some people thought of it as a waste of time. And yeah, they weren't very happy with the experience. So we're trying to work smart, and we had to find ways to solve our issues with the mobile application. And we started thinking about it. The first thing that we realized is we needed a NoSQL solution. So our business is very dynamic. We needed a solution that was easier for us to implement and gave us a lot of flexibility. So we started researching the markets, and we compared. So we found out that our application doesn't travel well. Yeah, you can see one very unhappy traveler there. So with typical client-server applications, you can incur a lot of additional charges when traveling, because Wi-Fi is not readily available on the airports, sometimes just missing, and roaming is expensive. So Europe is, I don't know what the size is compared to the States, but the countries are much smaller. So you travel from one country to the other, and you cannot use your data plan, so you need to pay for roaming charges, which is very expensive. So we had all these issues, and we started thinking of solutions. We had to find a solution. First, we actually considered building our own offline capabilities, but we quickly realized that it's not going to work very well for us. And so then we found out about Couchbase. And why we chose Couchbase is, first, we wanted to switch to a mobile-first approach. This ecosystem of Couchbase Server, Sync Gateway, and Couchbase Lite suit our needs perfectly. This is actually what we wanted to implement on our own. One very, very nice thing for us was the native APIs from the mobile clients, because this meant no learning curve. We were able just to jump into straight into it and start using it. We were able to use our own development tools, so Android Studio for Android development, Xcode for iOS development. We didn't have to learn something new or try to integrate it. We were able to use the debugger that everybody is used to use. And it was a good experience from a developer point of view. Other points are all the products are open source. So you can actually see what's happening behind the scenes. And for us, this is very important because security is very important for us in the company. We handle a lot of sensitive data, and we need to know what is happening there. And we cannot rely on a system that we don't know how it works. And with the Couchbase products, all the source code is in GitHub. You can go there, you can read the code and see what's happening. If you have any issues, you can either contact the technical support. So the technical support is really great. People are actually paid to build these products. And they're very good engineers. Or you can do it on your own. If you want to make some changes, you can fork it and just do it. The other thing is the developer community. So all of us know how important this actually is, because if the community is not big, sometimes it's very hard to find the answers to your questions, and even if the product is the best product in the world, it can become very frustrating if you don't have people to actually interact with. Other things are document conflict detection and resolution out of the box. Now, today we are not using, we are using only pull replication, meaning we don't care about conflicts. But in the near future, we are going to implement new features. I'm going to talk a little bit about them in the end of the presentation. So this is actually future proofing for us. It's not something that we need to worry about because we know we can rely on it. And so, channels. This was very important for us because we have more than 3 million customers on the mobile application, and we all know that people don't update their applications regularly. And one thing that I need to mention is, so in the travel business, we have a lot of business rules, which, for example, sometimes they prevent us to actually deliver the application if we don't meet certain rules. For example, if you fly to Paris, it's just an example. You may need to your application may have to meet certain business requirements to be able to offer selling tickets to Paris. And let's say they change the law and they say, okay, your application doesn't meet the requirements anymore. You have to either take it offline or make a change immediately. And otherwise, you cannot offer flights. For us, it's very easy to control these kind of things because we can simply say, okay, the old applications won't see this new route, and that's it. We're gonna be able to continue offering the old products, and new clients, whoever updates the application or installs the application, now they can use the new routes. And in the past, what we did was we had a fail-safe mechanism where we basically raised one flag in the server, and all the applications that just displayed a dialog, please update your application to be able to continue, which wasn't very good because let's say you are traveling, you're on holidays, and you want to open your boarding pass, suddenly you see this message and start panicking. Now it's really easy to control which version of the application gets which documents. And querying documents via views, that's pretty awesome. For the mobile projects, we are basically getting these enormous structures of data. Our seed map, so one seed map is 100 kilobytes of data, which you can imagine this is a single JSON document. And trying to load the whole document and go through all the nodes to find one parameter that you need, it can become very frustrating. And using the views, you can actually modulate the data in the form that you need it. And it makes things very easy to maintain. And for example, one thing that I personally like is I can change the schema. It's schemaless, but let's say I change the structure of the document, and I don't worry about it because my view emits a normalized form every time. So it's the same form every time. I don't care that the document structure changed. This means my old application is going to support the same document because it's basically going to extract the same type of information from it. It's not like a relational database if you change your table structure and, for example, if you execute select star from somewhere and start accessing fields by index, that can be pretty dangerous. So the other point was the sync gateway. So we really started thinking of our own solution for the sync gateway. And in one of my previous jobs, I actually had to implement sync capabilities on my own. And this thing still haunts me. I mean, it was a very, very tough thing to do. And today, I actually want to go back to my previous job and redo it with sync gateway and Couchbase because I did a crappy job. We very quickly forgot about the idea to implement it on our own because it can become a very huge distraction for us. So we basically have to build a team to do only this thing. And syncing data is not the core of our business. The core of our business is selling tickets. So we had to find a solution, a better solution for us. And the Couchbase, the whole Couchbase ecosystem came as a blessing. We're talking about change notifications and conflict resolution. These things can become very complex very quickly. Again, I'm talking from personal experience because I actually had to do it. And it wasn't a fun thing to do. It is going to delay our project and obviously increase development costs. And taking a product built by a company that specializes in that means we don't have to worry about QA. Again, this saves us money. And when we come back to the first slide, we are actually saving money to the company, which reduces ticket prices. And the last point is that we are not very clever guys, so we're not gonna do it, get it right from the first time. And you can see a very happy manager there. He's happy because we took this decision. So what we did was, I wanna talk about one particular problem that we had is we are using a third-party reservation system, which also handles the utilities for us. So these utilities are the markets where we fly to. These are the seat maps, so they depend on the type of aircraft that we use. Now, we own only one type of aircraft, but during peak seasons, we actually rent aircraft from different companies. And they provide us with different type of aircraft, so we need to be very flexible there. Because we are talking about, for example, sometimes in peak seasons, we can hire an aircraft for, let's say, 2 weeks only, or something like that. And change the application, release a new update in Google Play or iTunes, the certification of iTunes takes 2 weeks, so it will basically just make the whole exercise pointless. And what we do is we have this utility system which stores all these properties for us. And one challenge that we faced is actually we cannot touch this utility system because it's not ours. We don't have control over it. We cannot ask the people who built it to interface it with the sync gateway. So we had to find another solution. And what we did was, so we built this Node.js service, which basically, it runs every 5 minutes, goes to the utility, compares the documents from the utility with the documents in Couchbase. And if it detects a change, it updates the documents from the sync gateway, which basically the sync gateway creates a new revision and propagates the changes to the mobile client. Now, this may sound very complex because ideally you can just go from the mobile client to the REST API, but in the beginning of the presentation we saw how this thing works. It wasn't very nice. And we actually were able to save almost 80 gigabytes of mobile to network traffic daily, only because of this thing. And this drastically improved our response times, and people are much happier now with the whole application. I have actually published a small demo of this architecture on this address in GitHub in our Ryanair organization, so you can check it out. The project consists of an Android test project, demo project. It has some static JSON documents that you can just change in your editor and see how these things works. And the Node.js service that actually compares both documents. So how does the customer benefit from all of these things? First, we reduce the booking process from 5 minutes to less than 2 minutes. We have much less traffic between the devices and our servers, which means, again, saving money. And application is much more responsive, and we can see how happy Zach is because of that. One good thing for us is we can actually focus on selling more stuff to the customers. Before customers were just frustrated with the application. They didn't want to use it. And Ali mentioned in her presentation that we have 80,000 availability requests per day, but this is actually the old application. With the new application, we have more than 300,000 availability requests per day from the mobile application. The website is much bigger, which was a great improvement because I also have to mention that we released this application 2 months ago. So this application was live only for 2 months, and we see drastic improvement in the ratings, and people now actually start to use this thing. They just didn't want to use it in the past. We can see the new ratings now. They are very different from what we saw in the beginning. People are actually happy and think it's amazing. And we are also happy in our team. Now, what's next? We want to continue to use Couchbase for more and more complex things because we started believing in this product. So it has worked great so far. It's probably worth mentioning that we had a very tight deadline implementing both applications. We had less than 4 months to implement the applications from scratch, so we were under a lot of pressure. And what we did was we implemented the Couchbase part in around a week on both platforms, and we just forgot about it. We haven't touched this since the beginning of the product, and this was actually the only component that worked. We had issues with everything else, with the servers, with our architecture, with the frameworks, and Couchbase was the only thing that nobody thought about it because it was just sitting there and doing its job. And now we want to start using it for more serious things, so we want to... area that we explore is a recommendation engine. So basically, we want to offer you relevant data when you need it, when the data happens. For example, we want to offer you relevant trips. If we find that you enjoy skiing, we can start offering you new places to visit that can be a good value for you. So we are working on this personalized Ryanair experience. We also want to grow a travel community, which Couchbase can help us a lot there because all these things that I'm talking about, they are different entities of data, and we need some tool to help us work with this data. We also want to offer door-to-door services. So, for example, it's not only purchasing the ticket, but we want to get you from your house to the airport, from the airport to wherever you are flying, and after that to your hotel or to your family, if you're visiting your family or things like that. So basically, we want to continue to simplify every aspect of the travel industry. So far, Couchbase has proven that they can really help us with this. So we also play around with some ideas. For example, Internet of Things opens new possibilities for us. We are thinking about iBeacons and other technology that basically expands the user journey beyond the mobile and the desktop screen into the real world, because traveling is not only... Actually, it's nothing like sitting on your computer or constantly watching your phone. One other interesting area for us is the wearables. Everybody is talking about wearables. They want the boarding passes on the watches. For me, this is a stupid idea, but yeah, people like it. And also the peer-to-peer capabilities that the framework gives us. Now, our airplanes, they are not fitted with Wi-Fi, so people are very bored during the flights because we don't have these fancy screens that you have here and watch movies, and they're just watching the calls from the windows. And with peer-to-peer capabilities, we can actually bring some sort of an entertainment, because everybody has their mobile devices or their laptops with them. They can use them during the flight in offline mode, obviously. But we can. The technology gives us ways to expand the ecosystem of the software. So we're not going to stop. Our software is not going to stop to work for the clients the moment they enter in airplane mode. And yeah, that was it. Any questions? I think I spoke too fast. I don't know if people understood what I say. Yeah. Yeah.
On average, about how much data is stored on the mobile?
So we have around 3 megabytes of data, which is stored. Which is so this data is semi-static, meaning it changes from time to time, but. As you saw in the first example, this is 3 megabytes downloaded every time you start a booking, which is kind of pointless to do if you can just store it on the device. And semi-static means it changes from time to time, but it's very important for us to be able to change it immediately when the need comes. For example, one good example was from 2 weeks ago. So we have mobile boarding passes, but these mobile boarding passes don't work on every airport. Some airports, they don't have the technology, they don't have the scanners, or simply we don't, again, the country says, okay, we're not going to rely on this technology. So our application basically disables mobile boarding passes in some countries. And one example was, I think it was Rome, Ciampino. They saw that people actually wanted boarding passes on their airport, and they listened to the people and they contacted us and said, okay, we're going to allow you to use the mobile boarding passes on your device. And what we did was we just changed one flag in the station document, which was propagated by the SIM gateway, and people were able to use mobile boarding passes immediately without updating the application, without any hassle. And that's a very, very nice example of this semi-static data and why it's important to cache it, but have capabilities to actually update it from remotely. And yeah, and the other thing is our business analysts, they change like station names and routes, and sometimes they forget to notify us. So yeah. Having this service that I showed you in the beginning, it basically does all the work for us, so we don't have to worry about it. Yeah?
Regarding reservation data, so which should be handled in atomically manner, so how do you handle those data? Do you handle those data with Couchbase Mobile or with legacy database?
Sorry, which database is that?
Reservation data.
Reservation? Okay, so no, because the reservation system is not built by us. We are using it as a service, and we don't have any control over it. Fortunately, we just rely on other technology, which is basically a black box for us. We don't know what's happening there. We just have a REST API, which we communicate with. This is actually the only part of our application today that doesn't rely on Couchbase, is the availability data. Yeah. Yeah.
So how you measure the 2 minute booking is from when to when?
So this is a full booking. We start the availability search, and we add all the additional services that we offer to the client. Meaning you choose, of course you can spend much more than 2 minutes if you don't know where you are traveling or when, but that's user experience. What I wanted to illustrate is actually in the same environment, what difference it makes to this new architecture that we implemented. So we are basically measuring it from choosing where you are flying from and to, because in the previous architecture, the moment you choose your origin station, you go to the REST service, you download all the stations, And then you can actually see them in the list and choose them. Once you choose the station, you go to the service again, download all the stations that this airport flies to, and it just adds on the time. And now we have all this data stored locally on the device, so we don't request it from the REST service. We actually work with the local data, with the local bucket that we have. And all of this reduces our booking times, yeah, the whole flow of the application.
So the time we save is from the caching, local caching, the mobile, and the user-media communication?
Yeah, so basically we ship the application with pre-populated data. We don't even download it in the beginning, in the first run of the application, which was also very good for us because we can offload this. So 3 megabytes is not a lot, but when you multiply it by 4 million people, it grows a lot. And we can basically offload all this traffic to Google Play and iTunes. So yeah, it's their problem now. We just bundle it in the application, send it there, and people download the database with the application. Once the first time they run the application, we inflate the database. We don't inflate it, you just copy it from the assets into the app directory. You point your database manager to this file and say, okay, use this file. And everything is there. So we have all the revision numbers of the documents inside the pre-populated database, which means the first time it runs, the replicator is gonna ask the SYNC gateway, are there new documents for me? And the SYNC gateway, if we have added something new, it will just replicate these new documents, which it's basically just the delta, which may be one or two documents. And this significantly reduces traffic. So, yeah.
Do you use like, any other technology in terms of
other? In the mobile application? No, so we today the mobile application relies 100% on Couchbase. Ah, other technologies. Well, yeah, we tried to build it ourselves with SQLite, and yeah, it didn't take too long to realize that it's not going to work properly. In terms of on the mobile device, no, we didn't. It was we just read a lot of documentation and we decided to go with this product. So this was our first choice after going through all the online documentation that we could find. And it was a good choice. I mean, we didn't have to change it. We didn't find the need to actually try something else. So, yeah. Yes?
Did you have to write your own synchronization routines to sync backend as well?
Yep.
How much work is that
for? Honestly, I did it in the airplane flying home, so it took me around 3 hours. let me go to the slide. This service uses the SYNC Gateway REST API, which is very well documented and very simple to understand. And it literally took me 3 hours to build a small service that compares the REST, the documents coming from the REST service, to compare them with the documents that are sitting in the Couchbase bucket. And I'm just comparing them. If I find differences, I update the Couchbase document with the new document, which creates a new revision, and this revision gets synchronized to the devices that need it. So yeah, it literally took me 3 hours to build this thing. And
so that sync was easier than the sync off the device?
Sorry?
That syncing in the back end is easier than syncing on the device?
Yeah, yeah, because this traffic, this traffic here is local for our servers. It doesn't go to the client. And it's much easier for the clients. We are trying to improve the experience of the client. So the easiest thing to do is just to point the Android and the iOS applications to the REST API and consume it, but that's not what we want. It's very slow and generates a lot of unnecessary traffic. So we generate the traffic, actually, between the two servers, but it's local traffic. These both servers are in our data centers, so it's not so expensive to do. And yeah, feel free to check the example is there. It's you can play with it and implement your own solution. Any other questions? Yeah. Yes, so we use continuous replication. So basically, the moment you start the application, the replicator starts listening for changes. And yeah, during the session, you're connected to the sync gateway. And every time a change happens, you receive the changes immediately. Yeah, we are doing that. It's very simple. It's basically from the Couchbase API. You just when you create your database manager, you just say which file to use. It's one parameter. It's very simple. It's in the documentation. I'm gonna update the example because other people ask me about that. I'm going to update this example with a pre-populated database to illustrate how you can actually use this pattern. So yeah, after the talk, I'm just going to sit down and do it. It's very simple. Yeah?
Is there any use case in the application in which the client side is modifying documents?
Not today.
Okay.
Yeah, not today. In the future, yes, but not today. Yes? Well, the decision was, I don't know, I mean, I just went with Node.js. You can, it's a REST API, so you can basically use whatever language you want. You are not tied to any SDK or framework. So basically the Node.js service uses the REST API of Sync Gateway. And you can really choose whichever technology you want. Personally, I just wanted to play with Node.js. I haven't done anything with Node.js before, and that's why I went with it. Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry?
Is that same bidirectional
using the Node.js model? No. It's so basically the Node.js service reads data and. Actually, it is, yeah. In some ways, it's bidirectional.
So how do you do the comparison with the data on the side?
I'm using some Node.js module called, I don't know, I forgot the name of the module.
Yeah,
it's
what is the logic? I mean, how do you do that?
Okay, so I'm basically comparing, I found a very neat piece of code which compares JSON documents. And yeah, and
comparing it locally and then persisting it, right?
Yeah.
What about the other?
So basically, I'm reading the document from the API there, and I'm reading the document from here. So we have a mirror of these documents in the Couchbase bucket.
So it's a one-to-one map?
Yeah. Well, you can guess you can write your logic in the Node.js service.
If you think about a practical situation, right, you would have a existing database,
yeah.
You know, legacy, that has tables all normalized. Now you are trying to do this document model for this new generation mobile app, and you probably are going with a denormalized data structure, right? How do you do the same the other way? I mean, getting to Couch is easy.
Yeah. Well, here we don't actually have this problem because the API is returning JSON documents. We don't know what's happening behind the API. It's using some sort of relational database. I don't even know what relational database they use. Basically, I request the information that I want, and I receive it in JSON. And what we did was we stored this JSON document in Couchbase. and synchronize it to the device. So we were actually able to very quickly update our application to not to read the REST API, but to read the local document. For the application itself, it was using the same models. Everything was the same. We just transformed the network calls into a local calls to read the database. Yeah, which for us worked great because we had this enormous performance boost. Now, in your case, you have to do some more heavier logic in the service. Yeah, yeah, but yeah, going back, yeah.
I mean, how do you make the transactions persistent and when you have a failure, how do you recover from that? It's just one side of the puzzle. If you are talking about an application that has both a web interface and a mobile interface.
Yeah, so well, fortunately, we didn't have this issue, so I didn't worry too much about it. But if you come with a good solution, you can share it with us. Yeah, but yes, it's definitely a challenge. We just didn't have it in our application, so we didn't have to worry about it. Any other questions? Yeah, I think that's it. Thank you.